Okay, well, we're going to get ourselves started here this midday. I was going to say morning, but it's right at noontime. Welcome, everybody. Glad to have you here. My name is Laura Ryder, and I am the Conservation Education Program Supervisor for the Fish and Game Department, and your host for today. We got just a couple of things to help guide you a little bit as we go. If you have any questions, there is a Q&A box at the bottom. If you put your cursor over that, you'll see it. You can click on that. If you have any questions, please post them there. If you have comments, you can do the same thing. There's a chat box also in your lower screen, and click on that and it'll give you an opportunity to post your comments. There will be opportunities for questions and answers after the main presentation today. So we're going to sort of collect questions as we go, and then we'll be able to get back to people. This is a webinar series on climate change and wildlife in New Hampshire, and this is our third installment, if you will. And the topic today is on reconnecting watersheds, which is in reference to actions being taken to address increases in severe storms and flooding brought on by climate change in New Hampshire. The two previous webinars that we had were recorded, and we posted them on our YouTube channel, the Fish and Game YouTube channel, as well as on our climate change web pages, and you can see them there. Webinars, these can be watched as standalone. You can watch them individually, or we highly recommend that you sort of watch them all from beginning to end. They really do give you a really nice comprehensive understanding of what's happening with wildlife and the kinds of things that are being done to help mitigate and adapt to the issues that wildlife are facing due to climate change in New Hampshire. The topics for all of these webinars are taken directly from New Hampshire's Wildlife Action Plan. And this is a guiding document for taking action to benefit species in greatest conservation need. The plan was developed by Fish and Game and many conservation partners of ours in New Hampshire. And then to get started, before we go, you can see there's several people here staring out at you. I'd like to introduce our panelists and members of our climate change team. Nicola Whitley, who is the Chief of Public Affairs. Judy Tomosa, our wildlife education specialist. John McGee is a fisheries habitat biologist for the Inland Fisheries Division and is here to help add information and answer questions today. Lindsay Webb is our wildlife education specialist. And our main presenter today is Dianne Timmins. And Dianne has been for 21 years the Coldwater Project Leader for the Fish and Game Department. And as an added bonus, I would like to add that as of tomorrow, Dianne will be the new Chief of Inland Fisheries for the Fish and Game Division. So congratulations, Dianne. to get things rolling today, we have a video produced just for this series, which can also be found on our YouTube channel. And so what we'd like you to do is to sit back and enjoy the video as we get started.
Part of what makes New Hampshire awesome is the wildlife and habitats that are found in the state. New Hampshire is lucky to have many diverse habitats and species of wildlife that everyone has access to. Whether you hunt, fish, or watch wildlife, there are many opportunities to enjoy the world outside. The changes happening to our climate are affecting plants and wildlife in New Hampshire. As you observe and enjoy the habitats around you, maybe you have noticed some of these changes. storms are more intense with drought conditions in between. This impacts the way aquatic organisms live and move in these habitats. Summer temperatures are hot, with more days reaching 90 degrees Fahrenheit than ever before. This sustained heat not only impacts us, but wildlife that need to take refuge in cooler areas. Without early and regular snowpack, winter wildlife struggles as well, like moose carrying heavy loads of winter tick, or snowshoe hare that have turned white before the first snowfall. Traditionally, insect hatch and flower blooms match up, but because of changes to our climate, this relationship is shifting as well, meaning animal food sources are not available as needed. Rising seawater levels and extreme storms along our seacoast impact coastal areas. In addition to being a challenge for wildlife, these events also affect the quality of fishing, hunting, and wildlife watching experiences. Later ice in and earlier ice out are changing when and how long we can ice fish. The New Hampshire Fish and Game Department, along with many partners, are already studying wildlife and habitat relationships and working on actions to help reduce climate change impacts on the plants and animals that call the Granite State home. The effort to help wildlife will involve all of us. Planting native trees and flowers, participating in citizen science, making environmentally friendly choices like porous pavement or collecting rainwater for your garden, and being aware of your impact is a start. It is important that we observe and understand how these changes are playing out, especially how they will influence our human species. Climate change over time will affect all the ways we enjoy the natural resources of New Hampshire, such as wildlife watching, hunting, fishing, fall foliage viewing, and other types of nature tourism. We need to adapt as well.
Thank you, Lindsay, for running that. That was great. Now we're going to hand this over to Dianne. And Dianne, if you're all set, you can get started on your presentation.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Okay, can you see it? Because it switches screens. Okay. All right. Hi, everyone. So I am Dianne Timmins, and thank you for that exciting, tomorrow being my first day introduction to myself and my current job change. Hopefully I can still maintain a very large role in this brook trout work, just because that's where my true passion is, and really enjoy what I've done so far over the past multiple decades. So with that, we will get right into it. So today's presentation is, hold on, just bear with me for 1 second while I deal with two screen issues. It's not letting me change screens, you guys. I mean, not change screens, but move forward. Hold on. Sorry, let me just try this again. Okay, there it goes. Sorry about that. Whoops. Okay, it's not letting me move the screen if I share it on that particular one. So I apologize for the issue here. Bear with me while I get out of that. While I try to get out of this. How's that sound?
So Dianne,
there's always technical difficulties.
You go ahead and see if you can get that running.
Yep. Sorry.
And that's okay. And in the meantime, I can just sort of jump ahead and talk to people a little bit about some things ahead of time. So if when we get to the end of everything today and you go to sign off, if you could please keep an eye out for a survey that we send out as soon as you sign off, so that you can give us some feedback on, you know, the topic, the webinar itself, and kind of help us to improve on what we're doing. And I should also let you know that we do have another webinar that we're very likely going to do, but we're going to take a break for the summer. So this will be the last webinar that we're going to do. And so that everybody can go out and play. Basically, that's what we want you to do, is go out and play, enjoy wildlife, enjoy the outdoors. And everybody's kind of webinar fatigued or zoomed out just a little bit at this point anyway. So we're going to come back at it in September with a fourth topic for our webinar series. And that'll be in the marine environment. And it's tentatively scheduled for September 15th. And the topic is going to be on the salt marsh sparrow. And the two speakers that we have lined up at the moment are Rachel Stevens from the Great Bay Estuary Research Reserve, and also Pam Hunt from Audubon. So they'll be talking about some really interesting studies that are going on down there to help us really learn about some of the things that are happening in the marine environment. So how's it going, Dianne?
Can you guys see?
Yes.
Okay, so I just took it off two screens. So sorry about that. Let's start over. Hi, I'm
Dianne. Okay.
For that great introduction. With that, we'll get right into it for real. So, okay. So today we're gonna talk about interesting things that are happening with brook trout related to climate change and what things are happening on the landscape. So we'll talk about flooding, which of course is something we see more often nowadays, as well as barriers in the watershed and what that means, and how temperatures are increasing and what that does to brook trout and their habitat, and what we are doing about all of these changes that are happening due to the changes in weather related to climate change. So one of the big things is with climate change, we have a lot more crazy storms, as everyone can say, extreme storms, higher intensity than large periods of drought. These higher intensities are part of what we're finding. What people are realizing is that annual average precipitation, so rainfall, will increase 14 to 20%. And what does that mean for the Wildlife Action Plan, which is a document that was created to identify species of greatest conservation need and through a multitude of subjects. So not just fish, not just brook trout, reptiles, different bird species, et cetera. So all of these species that are on the landscape, the Wildlife Action Plan is a document that was created to identify those and come up with a plan on how to protect and restore, et cetera. So brook trout are one of those species of greatest conservation need. So of course, these increase in temperatures and increase in rainfall and freak storms will definitely impact them as well. So, and then the other thing to note is we're also identifying these periods of drought. So we're having longer periods of dry conditions, which of course dries up streams, et cetera. And then we have these high intense rain events, and basically the water is just running off the surface and causing mass erosion. So all of these things affect brook trout habitat, filling in streams, etc. So flooding will, I'm just going to move you guys down a little bit. So how does that impact brook trout? Why do we care? You know, brook trout like water. So what's the big deal? You know, the big deal is that with these high intense storms, and you can see in the lower picture here, that you get road degradation. So you have rain and different events happening where water's pouring into a stream that definitely can't handle these high storm, high flow and high water content events. And it causes the structure, road structure to erode underneath. And also you have undersized stream crossings that can't handle this flow. They get blocked up with various materials, sometimes whole trees, sometimes boulders, and long and short, it washes the entire thing out. So it just can't handle these events that we're having. And so all of that stuff on the landscape, including trash and various drainage ditches, et cetera, all of those get overloaded, and the trash and everything that's there, as well as increased sediment, goes into the stream. And so you end up filling in pool habitat because this water, this flow event is carrying not just boulders, but it's carrying everything with it. Like I said, trees, stream bank plants, you know, all of that gets run into this water, and hence you can see the brown, you know, and that fills in everything in its wake. So what you end up having is a landscape that was once pools and riffles and stable stream bank area, you know, you end up with a very homogeneous habitat. So it's filled in and you get flat, you get wider areas where it's cut the stream banks, and the stream has now become shallow with no pools and just a riffle run scenario. And all of that is a problem for larger brook trout and spawning brook trout because their spawning beds get buried as well. So, and the other thing is, as these things are happening and the pools are disappearing and the stream banks are eroding with high flows, you end up with large areas of exposed landscape where the rocks and the shallow water are absorbing the heat from the sun, and you end up with much higher increased temperatures. So huge issue for brook trout, which are high water quality species. And so you end up by increasing temps, the water quality goes down and brook trout just can't handle it. They're not a species that, they're still on the landscape. They've been here. There are native trout species as well as lake trout, but the brook trout itself is very picky. It prefers high quality conditions. And once their temperatures change, they do not do well to survive. Just showing you a picture from Southern New Hampshire after Irene. This was obviously you can see what happens. You get these maintenance events that basically high erosion, high road blowouts, and you end up having to do these emergency maintenance fixes. You can see the berm there that was created here that was created to try to keep the water back in its channel and protect this house. And so these events, obviously berming a stream is not exactly what you want to have. Streams like to move, they like to be sinuous. And so S-curves, you know, having that, it also slows down erosion, having that pattern where streams can do their thing and flow nice and normal through a landscape. And when you end up with this, you get a straight channel, you get berming, and obviously long-term, the habitat here is still very exposed and very susceptible to heating up. So as I mentioned, the destruction of habitat is huge, and these disconnected watershed occurrence happens. And so we have over 20,000 plus stream crossings in New Hampshire, and these crossings, a lot of them are undersized. And so the fact that we are having more of these extreme storm events is huge, because these are all areas where you can have blowout, and not just for species concerns, but also for people. I mean, roads are our access to emergency services. And so having roads blow out not only destroys the habitat for aquatic species, but also just disconnects the potential for people's safety. And so huge, huge problem across the entire landscape. But getting back to the flow purposes, as I mentioned, the increased storms and the destruction within the stream is huge to aquatic species. So, and also the big part here is that fish like to move, and they need to move because they require different habitats through their different lifestyles. So juveniles tend to be in more your riffle habitat. As brook trout get larger, they tend to be in pool habitat because they need that space. And brook trout are also very territorial. So having them be constricted into one pool tends to cause issues. Your larger fish will definitely eat your smaller fish. There's absolutely no question. We've seen that multiple times during our sampling. And so, and they're in a bucket for a very limited amount of time. Imagine if you had to be in a bucket in a one pool in a stream, because now the pool is separated by dry spouts where the stream has gone intermittent, it's gone underground. And so if these fish are stuck in this pool habitat, they're definitely going to eat each other. And so you end up with just a few bigger fish left, and then predation occurs from mink and otters, et cetera, and birds, and then you have no brook trout left. So this disconnection is huge, and they need that access to the cold water habitat during the warmer periods. And so we end up with an issue on the population status side during these increased events and drought periods. And also, of course, the reduction of spawning beds through sedimentation. And also, if they can't access the spawning beds, then they don't necessarily breed. They won't drop their eggs. They'll reabsorb them. So huge problem genetically as well. So just to give you an example, back in 2005 through 2012, we did a radio telemetry study using wild brook trout that we captured through angling in the Dead Diamond watershed. And so the Dead Diamond is just north of Arrow in Second College Grant. And during that period, we also monitored flows because there is a gauging station at the lower section of the river. So, and just to give you an idea, you can see here these big giant flow events that happen in the spring, which is pretty common. You know, and then through different times during this study, we had some droughts and some flooding conditions. So just to mark a couple years that were extreme, the red is 2005. And you can see in the summer here that the red is predominantly just at the bottom. I mean, we had very, very minimal flows, and these fish rely 100% on cool habitats. And during 2005, in July here, all of our tagged fish left and went into the McGalloway River, which is another larger tributary that has a bottom fed dam on it. And even during the extreme weather conditions, that river stays very cold. Our max temp was about 68 degrees Fahrenheit, to give you an idea. The surface temps in the Dead Diamond were upwards of 70 plus, and in some locations, 75 degrees. So huge, huge difference in habitat, and the brook trout are able to move. And as a result, they were able to survive and then come back and return the following spring into the Dead Diamond again. So huge, huge flow event differences here in 2005. And then 2008 was a nice wet year. You can see all the flow during the summer was definitely above the bottom temps. And then actually in the spring here, you also have nice even keeled flow, but in 2005, you see these massive spikes, which again, don't forget during the summer, 2005 was very dry. So this huge event here actually did impact, show sedimentation and erosion issues because the water was running right off the surface because the landscape was so dry. and taking everything with it into the stream. So the Dead Diamond is a larger river system, so it not a huge impact per se, but think about our smaller streams where high flow events like this are a huge problem because the water has no place to go but down the chute, if you will, and it brings everything with it, filling in the landscape like we talked about earlier. So barriers to dispersal, huge issue, as I mentioned, stream crossings over 20, I believe the number is 26,000 plus across the landscape. I like to call these sort of the hidden grim reaper, if you will, because everybody drives to work or rides their bike or walks, and you may cross over a crossing that you have no idea is there. And so this is what happens. You get erosion, you get high rain events, it cleans out the soil underneath the road, and then the road collapses because everything underneath it, its structure, its foundation is gone. And then you get issues with road and sediment going into the stream. So huge problem. And it obviously, once this happens and the culvert's gone, then aquatic species can't navigate any part of getting up to where they need to be. And then the other part to mention is there's also what we call perched culverts. So this is a culvert that is basically jetting out from the landscape as well as this one. And obviously not all species can get through this. And quite frankly, no species can get through this as far as fish. Even if they jump, they just can't navigate a straight up in the air jump and then have to get through the crossing with the flow, fighting against them the entire time. So huge problem. Huge hidden problem, because like I said, there's a ton of crossings that people make it across every day and have no idea it's there. And it's not just fish, it's also turtles, amphibians, other species that are trying to get across or get to an area. And with an undersized crossing, they're forced to go through across the road. And obviously, I'm sure everyone has seen mortality on the road. So, and also the other part here is the erosion that occurs. Think of a fire hose. So this water is funneling through this on the upstream side, forced to go in this small hole, and then it blasts out. And when it blasts out, it erodes the area all around it. So you tend to get this sort of wider area right below an impacted or a smaller undersized crossing, because the water during high events is forced through this, and it's like a big fire hose just pouring water into the stream, and it causes erosion and widening. So just to kind of get through some examples here, different things that you may see. Here's one that's that you can clearly see this crossing, it failed. And then they put another crossing inside it. So it's called slip lined. And what happens is that just makes the opening even smaller and smaller. And so, and also you can see this is still eroding and it's failing again from when they, from after they tried fixing it. So huge problem. You get double crossings on some of the landscape and the water is forced to go through two pipes. And in some cases, the water in the second pipe, it's completely dry. And then you have a dominant pipe. So now you're again forced into a smaller opening when the stream channel itself is much wider. Just some more examples. And then there's also these, which is a mitered crossing. And then you have concrete as a bottom base. And then this one actually has some additional drainage pipes in it as well to try to help with flow on lower conditions, but it's still very impassable for species. And then this is just the map looking at what does it mean? You know, why are we doing this sort of thing? And this is to basically identify across the landscape which crossings are gonna fail under various storm events. And what we're finding is that that number is a lot, as one would suspect. So huge problem, huge issue. What do these crossings have to do with brook trout? Like why, you know, I had mentioned earlier that they definitely need different habitats, but just to give you an idea, historically, we thought, we being people, thought that brook trout or any fish species per se could live in a small area. You know, as long as they had water, they were good to survive. And what we're finding is that just because water looks good to us visually, it is not necessarily good for the fish species. So during the seven-year brook trout study that we did, we found that 5 miles was definitely not even close to what brook trout need. So the dead diamond is a 100% native population of brook trout in the state of New Hampshire. It is our largest growing wild population that we have, and our self-sustaining population that we have. And these fish, we had some of them travel over 75 miles in a year. And so these fish are utilizing, here's the dead diamond. You can see the dots. The dots are not just one fish species, one tagged specimen. It's multiple fish within it and the dots, and they're just on top of each other. So there's a whole bunch of fish in this watershed that we tagged and followed them for multiple years. And their habitat basically shows, or this map shows, their habitat spans the entire drainage. So all the way up to the top of the dead diamond, into the Swift Diamond, into the Magalloway River. As I mentioned, that in 2005, those fish all left here, got way too hot. They came out and went into the Magalloway, where the dam has a bottom outflow. And so they literally resided up here with the main fish that we also tagged. And that's the darker black dots are the fish that were tagged for Maine. So they actually are sharing this entire landscape together. And so they have access to all of it. And then there's a dam down here in Errol, but they have access into Umbagog Lake, which is where they overwinter, and then come back and do their thing each year. And so clearly the entire landscape here, they utilize. So super important to the survival of these larger fish. What we're finding with these stream crossing assessments, is that the fish are stuck in what we'll call nodes, which are little segments where there's a barrier between, or barrier to barrier. So on the stream landscape, basically looking at, if I was a fish here, where's my first barrier that I'm gonna hit? And boom, here it is. And what that is, basically the average distance of those little segments is 0.6 miles. So think about 75 miles in the dead diamond those fish utilized. And now these fish in these developed landscapes have 0.6 miles. So huge, huge impact to species that are using the aquatic systems across our landscape. And the other thing to note here is that you can definitely see in different areas, there's huge development. And in those developments, you have higher likelihood of stream crossings. So this is the Berlin-Gorham area. And so northeastern top of the state. And you can clearly see that this area is much more populated with crossings than the area that is in Pittsburgh that has much less development and also dirt roads. So you also have impervious surfaces versus ones that the water can absorb and go through and become back into the water table. Whereas these areas here, the water's running off pavement, taking everything with it, garbage, et cetera, into the stream. And then also no sense of soaking back up. It's just running right back, running off and running downstream. So why, again, do fishing crossings disrupt watershed connectivity? And again, why does it matter? This is why it matters. All these different species are impacted, right down to bugs. And why are bugs important? Because they're the bottom of the food chain. Everybody needs some food to survive, and it impacts these guys. So huge problem as far as erosion and disconnection, etc. There are some crossings that are good. This is an example of one. And in this crossing, the bugs are doing excellent. They're happy because they can move through and fish can move through and everybody can get to where they need. And conditions are good. Water quality is stable. You don't have big mass erosion events because the crossing is undersized and fire hoses. You don't have any of that here. This is a nice stream that can flow under this crossing and have equal energy upstream and downstream. So I had mentioned the increase in temperature. So brook trout have a definite threshold. They have young in the year, we're finding through our various data collection that at about 68 degrees, about 20 degrees Celsius, young in the year, if temperatures exceed that, they are not surviving. So we are not seeing across our landscape where we have temperature and brook trout data above 68 degrees, we are not seeing brook trout young of the year, which are juveniles, babies, survive. So huge issue as far as if temperatures increase, what does that mean? That means that our areas that are susceptible to this are no longer going to support young of the year brook trout, which of course, without young of the year, you don't have adults. So huge issue. Areas that do tend to get a little bit warmer, adults can survive, but for very short periods. And anything above 75 degrees water temp Fahrenheit is not going to happen as far as survival for brook trout. So any of these lower areas in New Hampshire that have high road density, exposure to radiant heat coming off from, you know, wide streams, et cetera, any of those areas are going to be problematic for brook trout survival. And increases in air temp are going to, you know, simultaneously cause issues to water temp. It's just inevitable. So just to give you an idea, this is an interactive map here that I will show. And it's showing right now the current conditions in New Hampshire. This is a model, of course, which involves a variety of different data points, and it has stream temperature in it, it has air temperature in it, slope in it, different variables to come up with the predictions here. But this is current conditions, and within the circle is the area of New Hampshire. So this does span across all of New England and down a little bit. So this is current. This is if we added 2 degrees, if the temperature increased 2 degrees Celsius. And just to make sure everybody understands the map, because I'm not sure how your colors come through, if they come through exactly like mine or not. So in this particular case, you do not want to have areas become yellow. So anything going from that darker blue into that green and aqua and green and then yellow, that's problematic. But you can clearly see as we go across these predictions that the landscape is lightening in color, which is a problem. So again, just to make a note here, 20 degrees. So this sort of, I guess, call it darker teal aqua, you know, is getting to the point where it's critical for young of the year. And then as you get into that, you're becoming critical for everybody. And you can see lower New Hampshire is approaching that beyond young of the year survival color. Definitely approaching that beyond survival color. And still now we're stuck basically looking at, you know, the White Mountain areas north. And then clearly, let me back up. So problem is, obviously, your survival is now stuck to only the northern part of the state. Again, predicted, but also remember, this is just if conditions stay the way they were, variables stayed the way they were with just temperature increasing. But we know that as we move, that development is not just in the southern part of the state, it's increasing northward. And all of these areas are susceptible to increased development, which of course gets us more into what's happening in the southern part of the state with these predictions. So all of this landscape is definitely impacted, with maybe the northern part being the only one that survives if temperatures increased that tremendous amount, 6 degrees Celsius, could be very problematic for brook trout across the landscape as far as temperatures go. Then if we just look at our current conditions of wild brook trout, so this one's the opposite. We're now going from the yellow to the blue. So yellow is 100% occupancy. So you can clearly see that a lot of New Hampshire has brook trout, which is true. We are validating that across the landscape as we do our assessments. But just remember that a lot of our fish are much smaller. So our average size for brook trout in the state of New Hampshire is a little under 4 inches. And so smaller. So these populations in the Dead Diamond, why they're so important to follow is they've been extremely successful. And those populations, brook trout tend to be, you know, adults tend to range from somewhere in the 8-inch range all the way up to 20 plus inches. So huge difference in population and habitat. So definitely something we are striving for in other parts of the state. But yeah, so for now, brook trout, wild brook trout exists in multiple locations, except for the southern part of the state where there is a massive amount of development and their habitat has basically been lost. So just again, you'll note we want to make, we're looking at this scale in an opposite direction now, so yellow to blues, and you can clearly see colors are changing here with the increase in temperature. And now we're definitely losing everyone except for, or a reduction anyway, in everyone except the Pittsburgh area. And then again, getting into that blue, now we've definitely gone below the 50%. And obviously that's huge. So in a 6-degree increase in temperature, we're now looking at almost the entire part of the, well, the entire part of the state experiencing a reduction, but a lot of locations, definitely in the southern part, are completely extirpated. So brook trout are completely lost from the southern part of the state. So that was the predictive model. Now we're looking at what's actually happening in New Hampshire. So looking at just New Hampshire data to be able to compare what happens under different conditions of increase over time. And so this particular graph is showing the brook trout biomass on one side, and this side is the temperature. So you'll note that as temperatures are increasing here, brook trout biomass, which is a measurement of kilograms per hectare, so their weight over a particular area that we sampled, so the two units, kilograms and hectare, basically you can see as the temperature increases, we're not getting any brook trout. So not having any adults or young of the year on this particular, under this particular condition. And this is right now. So now if we were to, isn't it working? You guys can't see the increase, right?
Dianne, did you break my slide?
Oh, apparently.
Oh, there it goes. It just did it.
Okay. All right. So, sorry. Under these conditions, you can see that now a 2-degree increase, this is a reduction in brook trout. So we're not going to have these populations anymore at all. Under another under another 2 degrees, so we're now increasing, you can now see we've erased this population, these different locations. I shouldn't call them populations because they're under a multitude of sites that we have sampled across the state. So these sites that were in that range, the 18 to 20, are now gone. And then again, now we've lost all of these. So any sites that did currently have brook trout are now gone. And that is a multitude of locations in the across the state, but definitely from the White Mountains south, we would be losing all of those populations, which is huge. So, features of a good stream, what do we like to see? What would we love to have? Stuff like this everywhere, you know, natural stream beds. So, you have a variety of boulder and cobbles and gravels for spawning, and it's equal upstream and it's equal downstream. You don't have, you know, erosion or deposition or any of that stuff like you would if this was a very small opening right here. Think about if this was a road and then a small culvert and then the road again, and now this wide channel is now forced through a small hole, and that's why you end up having problems. But in this particular case, your energy is equal here as it is downstream. You can see a nice gravel bar here. You can see one downstream of the bridge. So just equal upstream and downstream, huge, huge issue. You want that flow to be equal. And also this has plenty of space to handle a large flow event. So an extreme storm can go through this, let the water rise up on the banks, and then come back down after the event is over. You don't have, again, that high energy forcing through a small opening where you would be likely to have erosion on both sides of the crossing and then blowing out the entire thing. So the other thing is short-term maintenance. You have much lower costs on something that's stable because the stream can handle those events. It's actually staying within the banks or maybe even flooding out onto the floodplain a little, but you're getting that energy to, as it slows down, the stream comes back down to normal and the channel resumes its pattern. So very, very different than being funneled through an opening and having the energy blow it out because it's undersized. So, and then having to do that emergency maintenance. And again, I have mentioned the public safety, huge issue. When something's stable, you don't have that problem. The structure is working and the stream is working, banks remain stable and the road remains stable as a result. So, and again, the species remains stable. Turtles can walk through this, fish can swim through it. You have various amphibians, so salamanders, everybody can work through this without having to climb up and cross over the road. So everybody benefits. So what are we doing? We're doing statewide stream crossing assessments. It's a huge, huge effort. 5 state agencies, we used to all do different things based on our different desires for data collection, our different variables that we were focusing on. Now we are all doing the same stream crossing initiative. We're all using the same methodology, which is huge. It was a huge effort and feat to be able to accomplish that, and great conversations in doing that and great partnerships developed as a result. And so now it's 5 agencies working and a ton of non-governmental organizations and volunteers collecting data on the landscape across the entire New Hampshire. So huge issue because there's so many of them, it's going to take time. But now that we're all in the same standard protocol, we can actually collect that data and utilize it for restoration across the landscape. So huge results happening, and it gives us a variety of information on the condition, on what the failure is based on different flow events. So a 25-year, 50-year, 100-year event, is that stream crossing going to blow out or not? So it gives us that so we can prioritize our restoration across the landscape. Then we're also simultaneously looking at brook trout inventories. So looking at areas that have brook trout through electrofishing across the entire watershed, and basically tying that information to the stream crossing, again, to help us prioritize restoration. And also enabling us to look at where we can do something to be able to help and support brook trout and public safety. So aquatic organism passage is just how it sounds, basically getting a species from one side of a stream crossing to the other. So these next few slides are variables, models basically that provide us with a score on what that particular crossing is doing or can handle. So aquatic organism passage is the stream crossing a bridge, like in this particular place, where a crossing was restored replaced with a bridge structure. And so now this particular brook has full aquatic organism passage. So brook trout and other species as those listed here, can clearly get through this, whereas they could not navigate this in the past. So aquatic organism passage, looking at water species being able to get through. And again, this benefits amphibians and other turtles, et cetera, reptiles. So geomorphic compatibility, this one's a little bit harder to think of, but it's basically, is the stream acting like a stream? So is the flow equal upstream and downstream, or is it getting impacted by a small fire hose type crossing where the sediment drops out before it goes through the system and you get this bar that develops, gravel bar, and you know, the water gets partially blocked. In this place, it's mostly compatible because you can see the water here on both sides. But again, you do definitely have a gravel bar. So it's not fully compatible, but you still have some passage. Whereas this one's a partial, you again can see this gravel bar developing, pinching the water to only one side. And then you have fully incompatible where the gravel bar is completely blocked the water from flowing, and this actually is, and the crossing here is perched. You can see it up in the air. Rocks had dropped out, and now you can't get to the crossing at all. And again, here, what this one's perched. So different systems, different scenarios, I mean, and the stream is basically taking a hit because the crossing is undersized. So you definitely want to have an open structure with water being able to come through, and the structure needs to be big enough that under flow events, high flow events, that the water can get through here without hitting the structure and causing erosion on both sides. And then vulnerability. So this is where the whole flooding event comes into play. You know, clearly you can see red is bad. So there's a whole bunch of crossings here that fail on multiple stream storm event types. So 10-year tends to be more common, used to be a 2-year flow event. We don't even talk about that anymore because they happen all too often. And just in the last decade, I believe it was over 800-year storm events that occurred. So we are definitely having an increase in these extreme storm events. And basically, as a result, having erosion at these undersized crossings or blowouts occur that are changing the landscape to in a negative way, causing erosion, causing the system to blow out, and all this gravel ends up getting washed in the stream. And then you have to have somebody come in and clear this out and restore the structure. So huge emergency type situations that happen as a result of the vulnerability and the impassability that these crossings are having. And you also get these mass wasting events where the stream bank is just sloughing again right into the stream. All of this sediment is coming in here and filling in pools and different habitat types. So once we collect all this information, I had mentioned the red is bad. This is the results of the modeling. You get a score on aquatic organism passage. You get a score on geomorphic compatibility. So the stream being the stream, equal energy upstream, downstream. Is that happening? Is it not happening? Flood resiliency. Again, looking at extreme storm events and flooding, what is the likelihood that this particular structure is going to last? And then tying that in with whether or not brook trout are present in that particular drainage or watershed or not. So basically, we end up with a map that enables us to look at all of those conditions at once. So red on top of red in the pie is bad. And so looking at red triangles, looking at red circles, and then is brook trout there or not, you know, that's what we're looking at. So in this particular one, brook trout are present, and then you have an impassable aquatic organism score. So this is a problem and definitely something that we would target for restoration, because obviously we want the brook trout to be able to travel in and out of the main stem or et cetera. So they need to move, and we want to make sure we're restoring that. The other thing that I meant to mention here, I say a lot about these crossings, but the obvious barrier is, again, dams. So dams are not excluded from our assessments on the landscape. So we are also looking at dams, and they become a major discussion point for removal, because a dam, you don't even need to have a model to determine whether or not that is a barrier, because it is. So, and a lot of dams, even though some across the landscape have been deteriorating, in some cases they have been in place for so long that they've built up a ton of sediment behind them. And again, if they blow out, they will cause that sediment to fill in pools and change habitat types. So definitely on the landscape, we're looking at those as well. Again, trying to target that balance that needs to happen under normal conditions, under non-manipulated habitats. We want that energy to be able to flow through. We want species to be able to move up and down streams, and we want other species to be able to do the same without having to cross over roads and get mushed. So, and also stability is the huge part here. So having the high water quality, having that flood resilience, being able to have streams catch flow and move up and down accordingly as the flood event is happening, and then reduce back to normal when, you know, it resides. So anyway, that's the different things that we want in the landscape. Of course, all of that involves collecting data and finding out what we have to, what we have on the landscape. So again, just the wildlife action plan, 50% of the greatest conservation need species utilize these corridors. So having that non-fragmented landscape is huge. Again, not just to brook trout, but obviously 50% other species need it. So what can communities do? Communities basically we're starting to develop different watershed plans. And so that's huge. And having the data to be able to fill in what's happening on the community's landscape is huge to be able to create that plan and have success in the future. So looking at various grant opportunities, developing landscape plans, all of that is definitely something that the communities can help with. And we definitely provide different presentations and different collaborations with communities. So working with state agencies is huge. And we also, you know, need the communities as much as the community needs us. So we're a small agency, and obviously the more partnerships that we can develop, definitely the better work that we can do. And again, the better success we have in the future. So developing working groups is huge. And it's huge for everyone. And just one community at a time builds a watershed, a successful watershed at the end of it. So huge collaborations are always welcome. Just a little success story here. This is Slide Brook, which is in the Nash Stream watershed. So again, looking at an impassable barrier. And then back in 2006, and then in 2010, that was restored with a bridge. And so now you have that passage that was needed for species. And we've had a lot of really positive results with our restoration work. So not just conversion from bad crossings to, or inadequate crossings to bridges, but also wood additions is huge. So, and these fish have responded to those changes in the landscape positively, which is excellent. And then again, just working with the communities and the folks on the ground in the local community is huge, because we can't do all of this work by ourselves. Sorry, it's a little slow on my end for some reason. Okay, and with that, I'll take any questions.
Okay, Judy, you can monitor that.
Yep. Dianne, we have a couple of questions, and either you or John can respond. We had one person ask, once the temperature goes up, is there a concern about other species moving in? I think they're questioning from a competitive standpoint, say a warm water species or something moving in. John, would you like to address that?
Sure. I thought I answered it for everyone to see, but maybe it didn't go to everyone. The short answer is yeah. It's not just the water temperature getting warmer that can kill off brook trout in a stream. It's also the competition from other fish species. So that I saw that question come through and I was like, oh, she just totally gets this. This is great that she asked that. So species like fall fish, which are ecologically very similar to brook trout, they can tolerate much warmer water. And if so, a stream is getting on the warm side for the trout, even though the trout might be able to survive it, if there's fall fish in there and they're all over the place and they come in, they'll start to outcompete the trout. And our data, actually, our extensive database of, I don't know, 5,000 fish survey sites demonstrates that very well.
Yeah, and just something to add to the, so for example, the Northern Watershed, the Dead Diamond, like I had mentioned, is a beautiful stream for brook trout. And I will tell you that the Rapid River is also one that comes into that whole watershed. So it drains into the Umbagog Lake. And also the McGalloway, which tends to stay cooler, that has all now been penetrated by bass species. So bass were illegally introduced into the Umbagog Lake. They respond to that habitat quite nicely. And as have increased in temperature, those bass have totally pushed out the brook trout and salmon. The once dominant species there is now bass species. You tend to catch more bass before you catch a brook trout or a salmon. So absolutely, if temperatures increase, they definitely impact the species that are there.
And in the interest of time, I think we have time for another question, just maybe one more. Are there any situations where a properly sized culvert is a satisfactory option instead of a bridge?
I'll let John.
I'll do it. Yeah, so think of it this way. If you're driving on the highway, and you go under a big bridge, bridges on our highways are for us people, they're designed to stay out of the driver's way. Can you imagine if all of a sudden there was something too small for the 18-wheeler to go through it? You get disaster, right? So so you don't want it to be too small. And I think that's a lot of what Dianne was talking about. But does it matter to us humans if it's a pipe or if it's what we kind of think of as a bridge? Probably not, as long as there's enough room there, as long as that structure is basically invisible to all of us driving through it. Same thing with the stream. If that structure is big enough and essentially invisible to that flow of the water and the stuff coming down, whether that's sand or big trees that naturally fall in, for the most part, it doesn't matter, really. As long as that structure is invisible to the drivers, as long as the structure is invisible to the stream, if it's a culvert on a stream.
And Dianne, one more. Has Fish and Game had to consider prioritizing culvert connectivity projects based on the inevitable effect of temperature rise in the southern portion of the state? Are we prioritizing the south, for example?
Yeah, so basically we're prior, I mean, if I'm understanding the question correctly, it's basically asking if we're making sure that we're doing restorations in the southern part of the state as well as the northern. So absolutely, I mean, so we definitely have identified, I'll just mention McQuesten Brook in Manchester because it's one of those anomalous situations where you have a brook that is predominantly groundwater fed and it's cool and it has a great population of brook trout, but it literally goes behind multiple plazas, through a very, very, very highly developed landscape. But because it has shade, it has a riparian zone to the best of its capacity and is groundwater fed, those brook trout have what they need. I will say that I had mentioned a lot of the runoff and these high events, it is full of trash. And there has been an annual cleanup that occurs and every year we go down and help with that. And that has definitely helped. But the big part here is that the riparian area, the buffer along the stream is intact, and it has groundwater. So remaining cool and having a nice stable stream bank and buffer is huge. And that's what enables that population to survive. So in the south, where we have populations, we are definitely working toward, you know, restoration as well. In areas that have larger systems that are exposed and warm, there is still a stocking program that occurs, but it's of course seasonal, and we try to monitor to provide opportunity for that. But restoration wise, there are definitely locations in the south that we would not be able to restore because the temperatures just aren't there to support the population.
Okay, so thank you, Dianne and John, for the presentation and for the answers to the questions. And Laura, I'll turn it back over to you.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Judy. Let me just do one thing here.
And while she's doing that, I'll just apologize for the technical difficulties. always something.
Yeah, I just wanted to, I'm going to share that slide with everybody. You can see that, right?
Yep.
Okay. Of course, the webinar is the one we're just currently having, but we have some links there for people to look at for taking action for wildlife. Mm-hmm. This was a great webinar. Thank you, guys. It was a tremendous presentation, and it's going to go right along with the other webinars posted. So please share out the links and things that to networks and friends so that they can come and also learn about all these interesting things that are going on with our fisheries and brook trout. I have mentioned about the survey and that our next series will be happening probably in September, so that we're all going to take a break and enjoy summer for a little while. With that, I guess I'm going to say thank you, and hope everybody has a great day and get outside and enjoy the outdoors.